From the time that I was little, I have always loved Disney movies. Now, no matter how different they all are, they all seem to have a common theme. Talking animals, a little bit of magic, and a soundtrack filled with heartwarming ballads we can belt out in the car. Or maybe that's just me. And then they're all tied together with a moral to give us a new perspective on life. Now, one of my favorites is the movie Lilo and Stitch, the story of a little girl from Hawaii and her crazy blue alien friend who comes to help her during her time of need. Now, the moral in this story stands out in a single quote. Ohana means family. And family means no one gets left behind or forgotten. Now, we can always all relate to this when it comes to our immediate families, but what about our international one? Around the world today, over 62 million girls are being denied basic education, and millions more are fighting simply to continue to attend school. Which poses a series of questions. Why is it just that the places in which we are born ultimately dictate our human rights? What can we do to better protect the rights of our global family? To better understand our ability to make an impact on the education for women and girls around the world, today we'll first examine how widespread this issue really is, next, why it is incredibly crucial we fight for safety and education equality, and finally, what action we can take as a nation, as well as individually, to make sure none of our global brothers and sisters ever get left behind or forgotten. So let's examine the severity of this problem. In the annual State of the World's Children Address, conducted by UNICEF in 2003, they found that 121 million children worldwide do not attend school. And of this 121 million, far more girls than boys are affected. UNICEF states that an estimated 65 million girls are being denied basic education. Now, it is enough to be uneducated, but all of the negative aspects that come with it later in life are intolerable. They go on to say that without basic education, children's likelihood of poverty or dying increases dramatically. Now, according to statistics from the Let Girls Learn initiative through USAID, the developing world, 1 in 7 girls is married before her 15th birthday. That means that approximately about 14% of all high school freshman girls are paired with a husband with or without their consent, because more often than not, this isn't by choice. All of these statistics show that this issue should not be taken lightly and is a problem that needs to be solved. However, these statistics can all be reversed by education. GirlsNotBrides.org states that girls with a secondary education are 6 times less likely to marry as children compared to girls with little to no education. Not only that, but UNESCO, the United Nations Educational, Scientific, and Cultural Organization, explains that a child born to a literate mother is 50% more likely to survive past the age of 5 than a child born to an illiterate mother. USAID adds that medical complications from pregnancy and childbirth are the leading cause of death among adolescent girls in developing countries, but almost 60% fewer girls would become pregnant under age 17 in sub-Saharan Africa and South and West Asia if they all had a secondary education. Edward Everett, former US Secretary of State, once noted, "Education is a better safeguard of liberty than a standing army." Education improves the quality of life for all people because it helps individuals become aware of their rights, make rational decisions, and protect themselves against abuse and oppression. Don't you think it's heartbreakingly ironic that this crucial education is being denied to 65 million of us in places that it is needed most? So how can we consciously sit by letting this continue? The lives that education discrimination has impacted are countless. There are currently well over 20 prominent nations that discriminate females by preventing them from learning, and many more where accessing education is both difficult and often dangerous. Take, for example, that of Nuru from Kenya. She was an excellent student with astounding promise, yet because she came from a poor family, she knew that her chances at receiving further education would be slim to none. Then there's Nadine, who has a vision where every child is encouraged to learn and every girl is told she matters in Egypt. However, without an opportunity to attend college to learn how to better serve her country, she knew that her dream might only ever be a dream. In the Democratic Republic of the Congo, 11-year-old Dorothy often struggles finding enough food to eat sometimes. When she was unable to pay for her schooling, she was turned away and sent home. These girls and so many more have the true potential to change the world, but how might we ever see this change if they cannot be educated to do so? Thankfully, there are many promising advances being made every single day. Many international programs that work toward ending severe global poverty, gender inequality, and enabling democratic societies to realize their full potential are also striving towards improving the educational rights for women and girls. Moreover, to tackle a problem like this, we must look at it from all angles. The question that presses our minds like a headache that won't go away is simple. What gives us the right? Who are we to say that the policies of other religions and cultures need to be changed? To this, I say it is not a matter of attempting to press our Western ideologies and society upon other ways of life. It is a matter of protecting basic human rights and the right to a free will. These programs, such as Let Girls Learn in conjunction with USAID, UNGEI, the United Nations Education Initiative, Because I Am a Girl, sponsored by Plan International, and many more are all making enormous strides in providing girls with the education they rightfully deserve. Because of these programs, girls like Nuru, Nadine, and Gorathy are all gaining empowerment and opportunities they never dreamed they would have. Nuru is now able to pursue a medical career with a scholarship, instead of being married off to solve her family's financial problems. With her scholarship in science, technology, engineering, and mathematics, Nadine will be able to attend college to make her dreams a reality. With the funds available, Gorathy is now able to wake up at 6 a.m., walk an hour to school, and stay there all day. All of these girls are examples of the ripple effect, the idea that one single spark of hope can ignite an entire world of change. UNICEF states that girls' education is both an intrinsic right and a critical lever to achieving other developmental objectives. Providing girls with the start to a quality education helps break the cycle of poverty, and the ripple of opportunity will affect future generations to come. So, what can you do to help spark this change? There is no easy solution to an issue of this scale, but it has been shown that baby steps are the way that this change will come. The first one is to acknowledge that change is possible. Just because something may seem like it's too big to tackle doesn't mean we should give up the fight. The second step is to support the movement both emotionally and intellectually, and support the women who want to support themselves. The final step is simply getting involved. There are numerous opportunities everyone can do to take action, such as buying a classroom in a box through UNICEF, becoming an ambassador for girls through Girl Rising, helping to tackle barriers to education through A World at School, and helping to raise awareness about the attacks on schools through the Global Coalition to Protect Education from Attack. These easy but effective opportunities we can all do to make an impact are endless, and the only thing to do is start with one. So we may not come from a different planet or have intergalactic powers, but just like Lilo and Stitch, we all have the power to help each other. Today we've examined how widespread the issue of education equality is, why it is incredibly crucial we fight for it, and some solutions we can all take part in to make a change. I think about all the possibilities in the world and feel incredibly fortunate to live in a place where my right to an education is not stifled based on my gender. It is all of our responsibility as an international society to protect the rights of those who are not as lucky as we are. A threat to a girl's education anywhere is a threat to progress everywhere. By helping each other, we are helping a world to grow and thrive for generations to come. Education provides more than simple knowledge. Provides hope. Hope that 65 million more of us deserve. Education is power. Education is knowledge. Education is the future. Let us all come together for our one big happy Ohana.
Well, Elizabeth,
yeah.
Do you have a question?
No.
Is there a specific country that's falling further behind? Or is it just...
You know, in a lot of places more... It definitely depends. Like, there are a lot of more West African countries that are doing worse than others. I was, in specific research, I was studying a lot on South Africa, because that's a place that I'm personally going to be visiting. And in the past 2 years, it seems that there's been a lot more opportunities available kind of compared. So I think that necessarily to pinpoint a certain country is more difficult. I would say that areas in certain countries, you know what I mean? Like that it's just, it's such a broad thing, and obviously different places are gonna be more progressive than others.
Right.
I know that for a fact that India is a big place right now that's kind of having a lot of issues, just because I think there was a slide that mentioned it, a lot of issues with young girls being married at a certain age and just not having that opportunity, so.
So since young and arranged marriages is a deeply rooted tradition, especially in India, how would you propose breaking this tradition in order to gain more educational rights for young women?
Kind of like I mentioned in my speech, you know, it's something not necessarily that we don't have the right to go in and kind of say, okay, what your traditions are necessarily wrong, but I think that it just comes down to if a group of people is being oppressed from a certain right that will further their just kind of like development in life, that's kind of where something needs to be stepped in. That's a very good question. Like I said, it's very, it's something that's kind of touchy, but I think that it's more just providing girls with the opportunity, and if more people see like, okay, we can provide you with education, or just kind of the word is spread more, like, then slowly I think more opportunities will come. Okay, we can go this way.
Well, we'll do a couple.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay, so based on your research, like, about how much of an education are girls in some of these countries getting?
Limited, and that definitely varies. There are certain places where, you know, because of their resources, education is limited, but also there are places where it is dangerous, that there are certain laws put in place, there are certain things that are trying to oppress these girls so that they don't get an education, and they physically will, on their journey to school, will be put in harm's way of just physically not having a safe trek to school. Maybe repeat the question one more time.
I guess if you were to compare it to, you know, our levels of education, like elementary, high school, college, like
definitely inner, the farthest that it goes in a lot of the developing countries that I was researching is if they can get an immediate education, that's about as far as they would go. High school is limited for sure, and going on to college is almost in a lot of places not a possibility.
During the duration of your speech, you talked a lot about the severity of the lack of education regarding women and young girls. Are there any other campaigns or things you could donate to that help the problem with
everyone?
Yeah.
There definitely are. I know that I came across some. I couldn't give you names right now, because unfortunately my research was just focused on ones that that did provide for girls, but I know that they're out there, which is awesome. And just the reason that I chose to focus on this was kind of the more that I did research, the more that I realized that because of different cultural things, because of different things like that, it's definitely a more severe problem for women, but that doesn't mean that it's not a problem for everyone in certain places.
How about one more question?
You know, I would say kind of at the end, it kind of just comes down to the action of it. Like, you can spread awareness as much as you want, but it's just going forth and taking action, kind of donating those supplies, doing those kind of things, just making, even it's just kind of supporting it as it is. Like, there in so many places, I researched that girls just don't seek the education because they just don't think that it's possible. But if they kind of know that they have a support system coming from somewhere else, like, yes, this is a right for you, yes, this is something that you should be able to have, that's something that they'll feel more comfortable reaching and seeking for themselves.
So. Okay, very good. Thank you.